I think it's so important to reflect on bygone eras, you know, and to see how the sport's evolved through the decades. There was certainly something... Well, I mean, golden is one way of describing it, but it was certainly a unique era in the sense of the danger, the jeopardy of that. Any time a driver got into the car, they risked their life. And that's astonishing to believe and to understand, comprehend how they were dicing with death on a weekly basis. I think that a lot of current drivers, current fans, feel that the sport has been sanitized to an extent. And that's not a bad thing. I'm always an advocate of safety. I think that's really important. I think that so many fans are drawn by the jeopardy of the sport. So I understand why... you know, if there's loads of runoff areas at each corner, they're going to feel like, come on, we want to see guys really fighting for it, and girls. But I don't think anyone could really understand what the drivers went through back then. I mean, I've sat in a couple of old cars and you're just blown away by the lack of, you know, you just got this dodgy old seatbelt and like no kind of... When you consider the structure of the cockpit nowadays and the safety measures that we're talking about, the halo coming in, there's such resistance to that from so many fans. But you've got to understand that one death is one too many, and Jules Bianchi dying very recently was a stark reminder of just how dangerous motorsport can be. Ferrari is iconic. You simply can't imagine Formula One without them, and you can't really say that about another team. And I'm sure that is in no small part down to Enzo Ferrari, about this incredible determination, and many called him a dictator, in establishing this reverence for the car. You don't really feel that with any other team. And as a result, it's treated as a religion, not only in Italy, but worldwide. If you ever go to the Italian Grand Prix, the Tifosi are another level of passion. I mean, it's crazy. There's not a single F1 driver on the grid who wouldn't secretly like to drive for Ferrari at some point in their career. I don't think character's missing these days. I really don't. You know, from interviewing the drivers many times, I see a lot of strong personalities out there. I think things have changed. Commercialism and sponsorship is such that they feel somewhat shackled when they're in the paddock and the pit lane. They can't really necessarily express themselves in the same way. You certainly couldn't conduct yourselves the way James Hunt did, for example, in this day and age. And there's too much at stake. But so I think different elements of the sport are celebrated in different ways now. But certainly many of the drivers will tell you, looking back, yeah, the bravery, the tenacity of these guys was unparalleled.
In terms of our current season, obviously Lewis, four-time champion now. Do you think that does make him the best ever? Or, I mean, because there's a debate. Obviously, Michael's won more, but Lewis, you know.
I mean, he's without doubt the best British driver of all time, and that's just astonishing. Michael Schumacher's obviously a way off in terms of his win rate and his world championship titles. But Lewis is on course for it. I mean, he's still only 32, so who knows? He may well emulate the great Michael Schumacher yet.
I think obviously over the last few years we've seen, particularly with a lot of the changes in engine requirements and things coming in, it was designed to make the sport more competitive after a period of Red Bull dominance. Do you think that has worked out? Because I think initially fans were a little worried that all it had really done had shifted that dominance to Mercedes for a few years.
I think all these things are cyclical. Every team's going to hit a purple patch and run with it. I think that's inevitable. The other inevitability is the bigger the budget you've got, the more that you can, more resource that you can use. But I think we should take great heart from the likes of Force India, who are punching well above their weight, you know, secured their places fourth in the constructors, and with very limited resource and budget. So it can be done, and I think actually this season's proved that Formula One's a thrilling place to be, and you know, edge of your seat stuff still. You know, all the critics, I believe, have been silenced. That amazing rivalry re-sparked between Ferrari and Mercedes this year. You just don't know what's going to happen from race to race. And even those big teams have suffered major reliability issues. It goes to show that no one's bulletproof.
The one question that each season we do keep asking is when we are going to see a female driver in Formula One, and why that maybe hasn't happened as quickly as I think people thought it might a few years ago. Do you have a feeling about when and if we are going to see women in Formula One and other top tier motorsport?
I really believe it's just a matter of time. And I feel that there's nothing physical that precludes a woman from racing in F1. Many will say it's too physical for women. I just don't buy that. You know, maybe you need a stronger neck for G-force reasons, but you know, we can all go to the gym and build up our neck muscles. At the end of the day, it's a perception thing, and I feel that women need to feel that the sport is accessible, and it's down to broadcasters like us at Sky to prove to girls that this is a sport where they've got a future. So the onus is on us to deliver that message, and there's really strong role models acting as trailblazers like Claire Williams, and there's young drivers coming through the ranks. I believe that as soon as the talent's there, we need to then give them the platform so that they can realise that dream that so many of us hold.